He likes to, he would like to, I mean, of course, he's a burgomaster of Tilburg. Okay, maybe not Maastricht, but still, it's Tilburg. but he will always want to be seen as a working class guy. Maybe he's the closest we have to it. But there's a difference between class and status, so we have to remember that. It has also to do with merit as societies. But what we find, and that's the point I want to say here, is that the unskilled workers from Central and Eastern Europe and the higher income workers, the richer earners in the older member states, France, Germany, Italy, our countries, support the EU. So what you find, so it's funny, yeah? So us, the higher educated, the higher income people are you. We support the EU, but it's the unskilled workers in Central and Eastern Europe. While the manual workers, so our working classes, and the civil servants in the older member states, they mistrust the EU. This is not a statement, this is fact, based on detailed surveys and detailed empirical evidence. So the EU has eroded social protection in France and increased it in Britain. So the European Union has led to more social policies in Great Britain and less social policies in France. So it's not so surprising that the left-wing British support the EU just as much as the right-wing French citizens tend to support the EU, because that's the way it goes. While the right in Britain, the left in France, attack the EU. It's exactly for that reason. So the popular legitimacy for the European project is low and falling and will get worse due to the perceived democratic deficit. But it's important to look at the different segments in society, and they're different segments in different societies. In France, it's very different from Britain. In Eastern Europe, it's very different from in Western Europe. So the contingent being for or against Europe depends on your class and depends on the country you come from. Maybe that's as much as I'll do for that. Now, this is democratic deficit. So, coming to my last two slides, we have what I want to focus. So, what have I learned so far? It's just as an amateur looking at the European project. Then I see something like, okay, the European institutions suffer from a huge democratic deficit. It's not really on the minds of the people. It's not in the minds or in the hearts of the people. And for good reasons. Part of it is that if Europe is just an economic project, that's not going to appeal to the hearts of the people, is it? If it is seen to be a closed shop, that much of European legislation is done behind closed doors, or in just the government and not in detailed debates with the parliament, it's not going to warm the public to it. If we see all the things I've mentioned, that there are still many tasks left for Europe to be done, which are different from the tasks which Schuman was concerned with, which Wim Kok and Ruud Lubbers were concerned with, but are the new tasks, the new generation. There's a nice book by Jeff Sachs on the global problems, which you should all read. But all those problems about the climate, about pollution, about famines, all that stuff, are people which I think when I talk to younger people, typically are much more in their hearts and minds. And these are things which really deserve a European agenda, and the old caste of politicians is not delivering the goods. So what do I really would like? But what can we do, perhaps? So let's try to be a bit pragmatic. I think we need an open political back. Think of America, where you had this wonderful months and months and months campaign of Obama, and then he finally won. It was great. Nobody thought he'd won. Clinton could have won. The Republicans could have won. But then all the issues were discussed. How come we don't have that in Europe? Don't you think that's weird? So we have I think even the provincial elections are more exciting than the European elections. And so there is something, as Hamlet would say, there's something very wrong in the state of Europe. So we need an open political battle between rival parties about things that matter for Europe, and we have to get rid of background politics among non-elected elites, and things will get worse, while European politics is more necessary than ever before. People may indeed no longer want structural reforms, although I differ on that, but you can explain it. But Europe is needed to tackle all the issues I've talked about: climate change, pollution, integration of minorities, global financial crisis. We need a more compact and different set of tasks for the EU, in line with the subsidiarity principle, and a much, much, much bigger focus on policy delivery. I don't know if any of you have ever read the statements coming out of, for example, the Lisbon Treaty. They look like Stalinist plans. they look like we shall do that and we shall do that. We shall get so much percentage there, so much percentage there. It's all top down. It's really written by French civil servants. It's not what I would call the bottom up kind of stimulation which we like from Scandinavia, which the Dutch are traditionally good at and the Brits are good at, but which is not a tradition in Italy and in France. So we have, need to have a much bigger focus on incentives and a much bigger focus on policy delivery. We have also testing how we've, not the inputs, but have we actually succeeded and passed them. That's too little of that. So the political reform to resolve the severe policy gridlocks, we need to move the EU from a consensual to a partial majoritarian system. We need to make, and this is, I can go quickly, I can talk for hours on this, but I think most of this is known to you. We need to make European politics more transparent, more accountable, and more appealing. And here I come, I think that the president of the EU should personify the EU and should be elected for 5 years and be nominated by the big pan-European parties in the European Parliament. So what I think, for example, is the Christian Democrats, if I were them, I would persuade Angela Merkel to say, you go and run for president. And not first have the elections, and then if you win, and I would suggest that the social democratic parties would find also a very appealing figure, not Tony Blair, but somebody else, who would actually really go and have a good fight with Merkel, and there may be a third person as well, and they would have fight weeks after weeks after weeks. How it's done at the moment is that all the parties do a handje klap, and then somebody comes out of it, and then they choose the only reason I was a candidate when Neelie Kroes was appointed, that it was a joke to get things, well, it was, of course, I desperately wanted it, and I committed suicide, but I didn't become it. But the idea was also to have an open and transparent thing, but our Dutch government was not even prepared to talk about it in the parliament, let alone to have an open campaigning procedure. So I thought, well, maybe, but of course it begins with a real campaign for the European presidency, and then they can have the power and the legitimacy which Obama has. Obama's got power and legitimacy, because he's won this election. He's made American politics kind of alive and kicking, and is, heck, can I say, there's enough reasons for European politics to be alive and kicking. So we need to go over it. And I don't care whether it's Angela Merkel or whoever it is, or even Balkenende. I would... So that means I'm finished actually. So the Commission should become more politicized. The European president should be elected not for 2.5 years, I think, but for 5 years, a longer period, because 2.5 is just too short to be able to have an impact and have a serious thing. And then we could look forward to a lively campaign. I see Jo, who's going to chair the debate and the discussion, looking slightly, but only slightly, impatient. So this is a good moment for me to stop with a design for the... Does anybody know who this is? Yeah, but who designed it? Does anybody know? It's the most famous person outside the Netherlands. It's not Balkenende. What's our most famous cultural person outside of Holland? It's an architect, you're close. Rem Koolhaas, exactly. So he did a whole set of designs for the European Union to give it a different, a bit more exciting flag. But that's something, we need to do something about branding Europe as well. That's maybe the only thing we can learn from Tony Blair. Thank you for your attention.